inside Angola. Driving vehicles laden with ammunition and fuel in a hostile environment is a dangerous job. We talked to some of the men who would undertake this task in the Angolan Bush War to recount some of their experiences, a task that is often not recognised or often spoken about.
My name is Paul Doughty. My rank in the army was trooper or a private. I served at one Special Service Battalion in Bloemfontein, Tempe between 1983 and 84. Did our national service there, and I was a driver. I think it's no different than somebody being able to sit down around a bunch of photographs and tell the stories, really. I mean, that's what people want at the end of the day. You know, some of these really slick Hollywood things are all good and well in one part, but they're just not sort of the gritty sort of truth of what happened and sort of real experiences, are they? That's what I find interesting about all the photos. None of them are great photos. I mean, some of them are terrible. I mean, because everybody had cheap cameras, they just snuck in anyway. The photos are grainy and everything like that, and some of the photos are posed. But you know what? They're real photos, you know? It's what we got up to, and it's what happened, you know? And they're on the real places. There's something raw to them, but there's also something real to them as well. And I think that's what makes it so authentic. It is a little bit sort of rough and raw.
No, I fully agree. I think that's the whole purpose of this. It's not to tell the everyday story.
The thing is, at this stage of your life, you know, if you've got something to share or there's something to put out there, put it out now sort of thing, you know, before you can't.
Yeah, because what you find is even things that, you know, when we talk, there things come up that I'd totally forgotten about. You bringing it up and reminding me. And it's not the big things, it's the small things. Can you maybe just talk a little bit about how you ended up in the army?
My story of getting into the army was an interesting one, probably not a unique one. I was born in England and grew up in England. And in the early 70s, my parents immigrated to South Africa. So I basically grew up and went to school in South Africa from about the age of 6 or 7. As was at the time, when you got to 16 years old, all the young guys in South Africa had to register for national service. Immigrants weren't required to do national service, but everybody was required to register anyway. So we got forms handed out at school and we filled them all in and sent them away. A couple of years later, when we got to matric, around about 18, everybody started receiving their call-ups. I wasn't necessarily expecting a call-up because I was still British at the time, only been in the country about 10 years. A lot of the other immigrants in South Africa, none of them were getting called up. And all of a sudden, I got call-up papers. Didn't have a problem with it because all my friends were going to the army anyway, and as is when you're that age, it was quite an exciting thing. And, you know, I wanted to go to the army. I wanted to experience what all my friends were going to do. But it was just sounded like an exciting thing. The only thing I can work out as to why I got called up was that when you filled out the forms, there was a little tick box that you had to tick. That if you weren't a South African citizen, the little tick box asked, would you like to become a South African or would you become a South African citizen? Which I ticked at the time was, yeah, I thought, yeah, I'm going to be South African one now. I'm not going back to England. There's nothing for me there. I'm growing up in South Africa. So I ticked the box and I suppose that's inadvertently volunteered me for the army.
Hi, I'm Stephen Tegner. I was in 1SSB during 1983-84 for my national service. When we got those letters asking where we would like to be placed, I actually said I wanted to be a tank driver, so I got assigned to 1SSB. So we went through basics. We were assigned our various arms of service, and I ended up in the B echelon. The A echelon is the armoured fighting vehicles and the main sort of fighting force. So the B echelon is the replenishment and support troops of the A echelon, essentially. Then the rest of the, after basics, the training with the group that I was with, we all went into the B echelon training. And I think I actually ever drove a truck, a SAML, before we went to the border. Then once we got there, you know, on the actual ops, there was this Lieutenant Fenter. He had a Querful, and I ended up being his co-driver and ultimately driving the truck.
Now, Paul, you were in a fighting unit and you were part of the echelon. Can you tell us a bit about what vehicles stood out the most for you?
Yeah, being part of the echelon was very interesting. In the SSB, each squadron had three main areas within the squadron. One was the armoured, which was the armoured cars. The second part at the time was the supporties, which was the sort of infantry element. And then the third main area was the echelon, which was the support. Because the armoured is a mobile unit, always driving around and doing patrols and tasks. There's always needs to be a support element, not only from a sort of an infantry element or a soldiers on the ground element, but also logistically as well. I mean, the armored cars run on fuel, soldiers run on food, there's ammunition to carry around. So the tasks of the echelon was basically to follow closely behind so that there was always a supply of food, fuel, and ammunition. It was really interesting because quite a few aspects to supplying the needs of an armored unit. And so as part of the echelon, we trained as drivers and we learned to drive quite a variety of different vehicles because you could always be asked and called upon to drive a different vehicle at any particular time. And obviously, you had to be able to drive the different vehicles depending on who was available at what time. So you might be driving a petrol Bowser or a water tanker or a truck with ammunition, truck with tires and spare parts, or truck with rations. All of those vehicles are quite specialized, especially the Bowsers and the tankers and things. There's obviously the work of loading and offloading, and then different places we had to drive to refuel and fill up with water and get the rations from and that. So it was always interesting from that point of view, is that we had a lot of different sort of variety of tasks. So sort of variety was the order of the day in the echelon.
So Stephen, what stood out for you about the echelon vehicles? Can you tell us about the different types of vehicles?
Well, you had the Samuel 20, which was the very small, the smallest sort of truck, essentially. Then you had the Samuel 50. The Samuel 20 we never really used on the border. The Samuel 50 was used on the border. That was the sort of the standard one. And then the Samuel 100, which was the lengthened Samuel 50, essentially. It had a double rear axle, whereas the 50 just had the single. And then the Querful, I think, was basically a Samuel 50 that was mine-proofed. So that was one advantage of the Querful. It was, you felt a bit safer in it.
And driving the Querful, what was it like to drive it? Because the cab was quite high up.
Well, it was difficult looking through because, I mean, you couldn't have any windows open because the doors had the armored glass on them and the windows. It wasn't the same sort of vision that you would have in the other Samuels, for example. And it got very hot in there. It had a sort of a fan system, but that, of course, that didn't work. And, you know, Angola, how hot it gets. So most of the times we drove with the doors open, which wasn't tactically a good idea. And essentially the only protection the mine proofing would really give you is if you were strapped into your seats, which most of us didn't really do. Yeah, it's a beast. I mean, it's we used to bunderbash behind the rattles and the, you know, it would chomp down that bush. It probably was better for bunderbashing than the echelon because it was almost the same size as a rattle with the big wheels and everything.
And then how many gears did it have? Was it difficult? Did you have to double the clutch?
I think the Querful did have it had 5 gears, and it must have been double D clutching as well. I don't think it was as fancy as the Rattle, you know, with the automatic gearbox and all this kind of thing. Power steering, the normal mod cons that one would get in such a huge vehicle as well. The decking part where the engine is, it was like a grid, and the guys would normally sleep on that a lot because it was like a huge sort of a bed, flat plate you could actually sleep on. So it was nice to drive. You felt safe in it.
Paul, can you tell us a little bit more about the ammunition? What type of ammunition were you carrying and in what formats?
The ammunition was always hard work. If we were doing training at Dubrook or one of the training fields in South Africa, the armored car guys would arrive at the training ground to do shooting for the day. And there'd be truckloads of ammunition there. And they'd have a nice day shooting, loading up with bombs and shooting and everything like that, and chucking the shells out and leaving everything behind and then driving off. But they'd forget that sometimes we would have had to have already driven all the way to the magazine before that, loaded up all the ammunition on the trucks, taken it to the shooting range, offloaded at the shooting range, and then collected everything back together afterwards, loaded it back up and taken it back. So there was always that part involved from the ammunition point of view. The boxes were always quite heavy and they had rope handles. So I remember that, you know, after a couple of months of loading and unloading those sorts of things, you had like calluses on your hands. I remember going home on pass once and my mum looked at my hands and she says, "You've got hands like feet." And I said, "What do you mean?" She says, "No, they got like calluses on them, you know?" And I remember that's the sort of thing I remembered from the effects of loading and unloading. But it was always good fun and hard work. And there's always a couple of guys shirking off and trying to get out of all the heavy loading jobs and things like that. That was the sort of things that we did. The 90 mil bombs that you used to have in the armored cars, and they used to come as a pair in a box. So there was two in a box. They'd be contained inside plastic canisters inside a wooden crate with the rope handles. And then the Browning belts. I think a Browning belt was 200 rounds. So you had a 200 round belt. And then there was usually four belts in a cardboard boxes wrapped up in sort of grease paper and then in plastic. And then inside a wooden box and sealed again. One thing you can say about the ammunition, it was always packed up and sealed up for sort of storage, protection, and transport. Obviously, that means that when you unpack it, it's a lot of hard work to unpack as well. They never made it easy to unpack. So that was the Brownings. And then the mortars used to come in boxes. I think there was four in tandem in plastic boxes, and then there was about four or six of them in a box. I do remember the boxes being foot and a half high, foot and a half wide. They were usually very heavy. Plastic boxes had quite sort of thin edges where the handles were, so it was quite hard to carry. And then other ammunition, like you'd normally have for the rifles, the R4 ammunition used to come in boxes as well, and grenades came in trays, boxes as well. From an ammunition point of view, it was always quite well packed, quite easy to handle, but often quite heavy as well.
Paul, in terms of the 90 shells, can you just give us an example of how many rounds you would normally be carrying?
A Samuel 100 is an extra heavy rigid chassis lorry, but it had a double rear diff. So it was a long lorry, and it had raised sides on it. And then you could get a 10-ton trailer that you pulled at the back of it as well, which was about half the length of the bed off the back of the long bed at the back of the Psalm 100. We'd often load an entire Psalm 100 up to the raised sides and a trailer for a day's shooting. When we went out operationally in the operational area, we'd probably have a Psalm 50. It would be a mine-proof Psalm 50, so that it would be a queerful. So the driver's cab would be mine-proof, but the back was the same size as a normal Psalm 50. And the Psalm 50 was slightly smaller, shorter than the Psalm 100. And we'd probably have one of those fully loaded with ammunition, or maybe two of those to drive around and follow the armored cars wherever they were doing their tasks. If you needed more, we'd obviously have different depots and magazines where you could collect from. I remember in Oshakati, we had a magazine on the base. And then I think if I remember correctly, at Ruakana, we went into Ruakana on occasions and got ammunition there if we needed. But because the armored cars had quite specialized ammunition, I think it was only a few places that we could load up ammo.
In terms of talking a little bit more about Oshakati and being in the operational area, can you tell us a little bit more about some of the tasks you did there?
Oshakati was the main base in Sector 10, 10 Armored Car Squadron. And we were sort of based there when the armored guys went out doing patrols. And what we would do is we would load up supplies from Oshakati, food and ammunition, water and fuel. And then we would drive to set up a temporary base sort of in the area where the guys were riding patrols and doing patrols or doing their tasks. We'd establish a base, and then they would come back there to refuel and restock with food and ammunition if needed. And then they would stay over there maybe a night or a couple of days and carry on, or they would literally just drive in, refuel and drive out. So we would set up temporary bases closer to the tasks that the guys were doing.
And where were these bases, Paul? Because there were some in Angola and in other areas. Can you tell us a bit more about where you set these bases up?
Bit difficult to say exactly where they were, because I don't even know if we knew where they were. We would sort of find out where the guys were riding patrols and then set up what we thought would be a safe place. I do remember one base that was set sort of behind some mounds of sand so that we weren't seen, or it was quite sort of hidden away when the guys were doing the power line patrols. And so they'd come in from the power line patrols, and we were based there for quite a while. One of the other bases that we had that I do know of where it was at the Kalaek Dam. And we were based there for quite a while. We had a temporary base next to the river. We set up there and stayed there for quite a long time, and the guys were coming in from patrols and refueling while they were there. There was also a detachment of mortar guys from another unit on the dam wall itself, and they were sort of protecting. There was a footbridge that crossed over the Kaneni, and so they, that was their task there. So we sort of, in conjunction with them, we had a sort of temporary base near the river. As I say, we were there for quite a while the guys were coming and going with refueling and restocking when they were doing the their patrols and their tasks within Angola, mostly along the Kaneni River there.
Okay, so basically we, I think we all had sort of certain roles to do, and one of mine was actually manning the radio post. The airlines went out on patrol. You know, I was one of the guys that just had to man the radio and make sure that something, you know, if something important came through. But yeah, so basically our role was just to sort of act as a listening post and sort of keep a listen out and a lookout. There was a tree next to the river which we had to climb and sort of look around with binoculars and just see, keep an eye on the enemy, so to speak.
Paul, what was it like to be driving a huge truck full of ammunition? You know, how did you feel about that? Did you ever think about it, or did you just get on and do it?
One of the advantages, I suppose, of doing your national service when you're that young is that you don't really worry or think about those sorts of things. I mean, obviously, every now and again, you might get worried if things start happening around you, or if the enemy would sort of fire mortars at night or something to you and things like that. To be honest with you, I don't remember sort of fearing too much at that time. You're just young and you just don't think that anything's going to happen to you. Obviously, things do happen and things did happen. You just never believe anything's going to happen to you. Driving in those sorts of situations, it's quite interesting. You're well trained anyway. I mean, we had guys, sappers, sweeping the roads during the day, so you'd sort of feel pretty confident that the roads were safe to drive on, that the mines had been cleared or that there were no mines. A lot of the time we would drive off-road, so you'd drive next to the road and bundu bash, or just drive through the sort of vegetation rather than drive on the roads. And then following in the tracks and the vehicle in front of you, staying in whoever was riding lead at the front, driving lead, you'd stay in their tracks so that everybody drove in one route. It's interesting though, I mean, all the training that we had when we were in South Africa for the operational area, driving lorries and SAMLs, when we actually got to the border, I ended up changing over from a SAML into an armoured car, and I became the Sergeant Major's armoured car driver. So for one of the tours up then, I ended up driving an armoured car all the time I was up there. So you asked about driving lorries up there. I must be honest, I didn't have a lot of experience driving lorries in the operational area in Angola other than convoys, when we would do the convoys on the tar roads or the made-up roads back and forward to either Krootfontein or wherever we were going, we were doing the convoys.
Now, there was some risk that if you crossed into Angola, there was a personal risk to you. Can you talk a bit about that?
Yeah, it was an interesting thing that I wasn't even aware of. The Sergeant Major told me about this. And again, being 18, young and not really worrying, you sort of just take it in your stride. I was told that when we arrived there that the echelon would sort of stay, would always be behind the lines, and which was a good thing for me because, as I was told, because I wasn't South African at the time, I hadn't been naturalized as a South African citizen. I was still British at the time. I was told that I don't want to be too far up the front in case I get caught by the enemy as a non-South African. And I just thought they were joking about it. Apparently it was a real thing. But it wasn't a good idea to be sort of caught by the enemy if you weren't South African. And then the day that we crossed over into Angola, the Sergeant Major told me I need to keep an eye out now, make sure I don't get caught now, because we're crossing the border into Angola. And I thought he was just joking, but apparently he was quite serious. Nothing ever came of that. But again, I just don't think at that age, you just don't worry about it. You're invincible. There was, I suppose, a small risk. I mean, in the years that South Africa was fighting in the border war, there were a few people captured, but I don't think it would have been sort of in our scenario. But I suppose there was always a risk there. Fortunately, nothing ever came of it.
You spoke about the repairs and the spare parts. What type of repairs were you doing, and what type of spare parts were you carrying?
A lot of repairs took place, and a lot of it took place in the bush. when we used to set up the temporary bases, obviously we weren't riding patrols every day. So when the guys weren't there filling up with fuel and refueling, and there was a lot of downtime in between, or not downtime, but time when we didn't have a lot to do. So a lot of the repairs needed to be done during that time. So we do maintenance on our own vehicles, but as you well know, the armored car wasn't always the most reliable vehicle, and there was often things that would go wrong with it. And obviously riding through the bush and on those rough terrains and not riding on the roads, a lot of damage and a lot of repairs were required on the vehicles. So we'd often do that. We had tiffies or mechanics with us on occasions. I remember the one time when we were at the temporary base at Kaluek, one of the armored cars came in. The engine mountings had cracked and broken. On the back of the Samuels, we always carried spare parts, wheel stations and steering arms and spare wheels and even engines. But on this occasion, the engine mount had broken in one of the armored cars. The only way to be able to drive the armored car, because we were so far away, would be to repair the engine mount. We removed an engine in the bush with a lot of, I remember we used a lot of fan belts linked together and a lot of hands. We lifted out the engine, took the engine out of the earlant, put it down on some tires. The guys towed the earlant without its engine all the way back to Ruokana, where it was welded. The bracket was welded, and then they towed it all the way back and then put the engine back in while we were down next to the river at a temporary base, put the engine back in and got the vehicle back on the road again. So I remember that sort of repair that we did on the side. The other sorts of repairs, we were driving through the bush one day and my armored car hit a tree stump. It was an old Portuguese forest. They'd done some forestry there and cut all the trees down, and it was overgrown. We were driving through there and the front wheel hit a tree stump, which was too small to see in the bush. And the steering swung to one side and snapped off. Fortunately, the tiffies that were with us in the buffalo, because we had a buffalo with some sappers with us as well, infantry. One of the spare parts that he used to bring with was a steering arm. So we did the steering arm repair in the bush, just on the side. We just pulled over, changed over, put a new steering arm, then off we drove again, which was really good, because when you've been driving through the bush all day, you know, it's not easy to sort of, even if you could get towed back, if you can't steer, it's very difficult. There was another time that we did a repair in the bush where we didn't have the spares with us, but we had to improvise, and we had some campers with us doing they were the infantry guys, and we were driving a patrol. The steering arm or the torsion bar at the front of the biffle, the ball joint broke off. There was no way of towing back because you couldn't steer the biffle. The only way to repair it was to connect up the bar again. They took a hammer and a screwdriver to try and knock this ball joint out, because the idea was that once they got the ball joint out, they put a deshackle between the two arms and then just sort of link it with a shackle, just so that you could sort of drive it in a straight line at least, or at least drive it using the steering arm. No matter what they tried with hammers and screwdrivers or whatever, they couldn't get this ball joint out. So someone had a bright idea to shoot it out. So they did no more than stood it up against the tree. And the campers had R1s, which was probably a bit more powerful than the R4. And they shot this plate off, the plate that was covering the ball joint. And they literally shot it off, knocked the ball joint out, put the steering arm back on, linked it up with a shackle, and off we drove again and got back to the temporary base. The other thing was the spare tires as well. I mean, the Airlines, as you know, go through tires on a regular basis. And we had a lorry that was just completely full of spare wheels and spare tires, basically on the rims. And we'd go through them. The Yelland has a run flat tire, which you can drive on for a number of miles before it's not rideable. So you could usually get back to base on that and then obviously change your wheel from there. Now, my Yelland 60, we had been through so many spare wheels on the Yelland's coming back and forward that we didn't have a chance to take the lorry back, the Samuel back to Oshakati to get new wheels. And we were so short of wheels that my Elan 60 was basically put up on blocks, and all the wheels were taken off of my Elan, used for the guys riding patrols. Always made a plan or a contingency.
Well, you had no choice.
No.
Paul, living on one of those temporary bases, how did you find that? Did you quite enjoy that?
Yeah, the temporary bases were basically just wherever we decided to stop and form the base. We didn't really have a lot of infrastructure there. We were sleeping in our sort of bivouacs or your sort of temporary tents that you made from your ground sheet or your canvas that you had. A couple of guys might have had a small tent, but they were very, very rough, very sort of primitive. So from that point of view, they weren't very comfortable. And then basically passing the time away when things weren't happening was also quite a thing. And we used to play chess and play a few games and things. I think also your trench, your foxhole became your sort of work of art. So you dig it out and make it as comfortable as you could and make it as nice as you could. You know, sometimes your little trench that you dig would be just a hole in the ground as quick as you could dig it. But when you had a lot of time to pass, you sort of tended to sort of make a little seat inside there, make them a bit more comfortable. I remember, I think it was Staff Sergeant to Blanche or Sergeant to Blanche at the time. He dug his one right next to the river because his tent was near next to the river. The river rose overnight after some rain and his trench turned into a small bath as the water table rose. So I think he got young Fenter to dig him a new one. In the temporary bases, it was always good to see the guys coming in after patrol as well. It's always good when your buddies come back and you haven't seen them for a while and everybody catches up. Temporary bases could sometimes be very busy, like I said earlier, about changing an engine, repairing vehicles or doing those sorts of tasks. And then sometimes it could become quite quiet. I remember at the river, we did have opportunities to do a bit of fishing and swimming in the river as well. Probably not very safe. He did it all the same. And then to get a bit of fresh meat when somebody caught a fish was always quite good as well. Yeah, the Biffle engine cover works quite well as a braai grid if you've got nothing else to braai on.
Yeah, there were quite a few crocodiles in that river.
Yeah, you just got to stay close to shore, I think. Yeah, we were quite lucky. We were on the lower side of the dam wall, so all the water that came down from the dam wall was quite fast flowing. It wasn't like on the sort of upper side of the river where it was very still and stagnant. And the water did flow quite strongly from the dam itself because it was flowing through the spillways and coming over the dam. I mean, the dam at Kaluek was a project the Portuguese built, I believe. It was supposed to be a hydroelectric plant, so it was quite a big, substantial dam.
Yeah, we had a water bowser there, and obviously we had to use water sparingly, but we were next to the Kanani River, so you could always have a wash in that. But you had to be careful because apparently there were crocodiles. But what surprised me about the Kanani is it's like sea sand. There's no mud. In fact, the whole of Angola, I don't think I could find one stone. You know, everything was like sea sand throughout, even southwest. The rainy seasons were horrible, you know, when you're trying to sleep at night. I mean, I slept under the Samuel's diff, you know, just so I got some sort of protection overhead. When the barrage of the artillery guys we're driving with would open up, then I would wake up with a start and bang my head on the bloody diff.
Talking about rat packs, I remember that we used to go and collect them from the depots. We'd make like a human chain and we'd have about 10 guys and you just sort of pass them, swing them down the chain like this human chain of these boxes. It used to do. We'd count them as they go along. Whoever was there, the sergeant major, whoever was sort of issuing them and everything like that, we'd have to count every box that we passed along. If whoever was supervising it turned their back, we'd say, 37, 38, and then just pass one in between so we get an extra box or a couple of extra boxes, you know. You'd call out one but pass two boxes on, you know. We'd end up with extra rations.
Actually, each truck, you know, was a microcosm of full supply, you know, so you'd have ammunition, you'd have rations, normally not water, but you'd have everything on one truck. So it was essentially a redundancy measure. Say one truck got hit, for example, then all the ammunition wasn't gone, all the food wasn't gone. So that was quite a clever idea on part of the army.
But were you doing resupply for the patrols or what were you doing there?
Yeah, we were actually driving around with the Cape Artillery guys as well. So we were for a brief period, we were driving around with them and then at night they would open up and give a good night kiss to the enemy, you know, fire a salvo in their general direction. And we would then go to sleep and then get up in the morning and then move on to the next position. So you're always mobile. You're never static for long because obviously you don't want to be sort of pinned down by the enemy. You're always on the move. So you're never even camped long in one place.
And in terms of the supplies, can you tell us about the different supplies? How did the replenishment work?
In the operation to replenish the trucks, it was a collection point that we actually would go and replenish the trucks and then go back into the bush.
And then what sort of supplies were you replenishing? What was it?
Okay, well, there was the rat packs, the dryer rations, as they call them, which was the boxes, you know, the troops, the food, and then the ammunition, the rounds, was mainly 90, echelon 90 rounds. I think the water came in water bowsers, the water bunkers.
And petrol, how did the petrol come up?
That was probably the petrol trucks, the tankers. We drove all together, you know, so you had the water bunkers, you had the petrol bunkers, and you had the food and ammo trucks like we were. Yeah, so we'd actually line up one behind the other, the trucks, and then as the armored cars would pull in, then they'd have a long row of trucks that they'd pass. I'd first pick up your ammunition or food, next one get your water, and next one get your diesel or whichever particular order that it was decided would be the best first. Being in the B echelon, we were actually privileged because we had access to everything. You know, the guys out in the field, you know, they ran out of this, that, and the other, but we always were, you know, sitting pretty with all the supplies on the back of the truck. So from a comfort point of view, we weren't that bad.
And so were you quite close to the armor cars, or did you guys hang back a bit?
I think a lot of the times we actually followed, like a certain amount of trucks would follow a troop around, so they always have access to replenishments. And then at night we'd even camp with each other. And then, yes, it was pretty much digging trenches every night. I hated that with a passion because I could never get to sleep in those trenches. You know, you had sand and everything inside, you go inside your clothes. So we would normally encamp together with a troop of armored cars. So basically we would obviously hang back. We wouldn't sort of be as advanced as the armored cars, but they would obviously be within shouting distance, well, so to speak, you know, to be able to get supplied and resupply. So we wouldn't actually wander too far away from them. I doubt very much it was the trucks sort of all in one spot and then everybody was spread far and wide. So I think that's the way it actually happened. So you supply the troops. They'd go off and do patrols, whatever the case may be, whatever action. And then we'd basically encamp and then stay and then sort of try and keep ourselves busy and occupied for the various hours that it took to wait. That was the hardest part, of course, waiting and sitting and doing nothing. So I read a lot. Yeah, I woke up fast asleep. Christmas morning, there's mortar bombs falling around us, and the guy jumps up next to me and says, "Well, fuck, he come cuck now. And then I think we rapidly deployed and rode away, and that, you know, went. But that was a nice Christmas morning present. Fortunately, nothing bad happened. We can be really grateful for. I personally didn't see any sort of anything traumatic, which once again, I can actually thank God for, because I don't know, a lot of people, it seems like they're still dealing with a lot of issues from those days. I suppose like most people remember the good things in good memories. They forget about the bad things. You know, those were good times.
And were you ever ambushed or anything?
Yes, actually, there was one time we were driving. It was quite a huge sort of fighting group. We were moving forward. We were actually relatively far forward. But anyways, then we came under a barrage of fire, and that was probably the closest that I came to injury. So we quickly did a U-turn and got the hell out of there. And then, but I can't tell you where it was.
Stephen, how did you feel when you came under that barrage? Did anything go through your mind?
Yeah, it happened so fast that you don't really sort of take it in. You know, when you're young and 19, you know, you can handle the world and you think you're invincible. I suppose looking back in hindsight over the years, it sort of makes you realize that it's far more dangerous than I actually realized. I suppose adrenaline pumping, you know, but survival instinct kicks in and you just sort of carry on and don't really think about these things. It was exhilarating, let's put it that way. As a truck full of ammunition, that's a daunting thought. And as rounds came falling down, one could have easily hit the truck. One helicopter came in and we had to rush in and get the post bags. So there was a quick thing landed, so the rotor still swirling. Grab the post bags, drag them away from the scene, and the helicopter would take off. And mail was always very important, of course. I don't know how it would work in this day and age, you know, with instant messaging and all the rest of it. But back then it was a big thing. And we would all get parcels and we'd all share it with one another. It was never a case of, well, this is mine. And
now, Paul, is there something that really stands out from your army days?
I would say the thing that stands out most from my days in the army would be the people. I mean, from the day you get on the train to start your national service, most of us, or from my personal side anyway, came from a quite a comfortable sort of middle class family, quite well protected, think you're wise and you think you know the ways of the world and you think you know people, you're thrust into a two-year sort of adventure whereby you meet people from all walks of life, from all cultures, from all situations, and you make some incredible friends. The term brothers in arms is not, you can't use it too lightly. I mean, you do make friends and brothers that you never had before that you can rely on and turn to for the rest of your life. You just grow so quickly and you grow so much in a short time. War is never a good thing and it's never a great experience, but it does grow you very rapidly and you learn so much about life and about the world and about people in such a short time. And the whole thing is it's all about people. You know, whether it's the people you're serving with, the people that you're serving, or the people that you're fighting against. You learn a lot of practical things in the army and you learn a lot of skills. You see a lot of things and you experience a lot of things. But I think at the end of the day, the thing that comes out of it most, the friendships and the relationships you have with people, it changes you very, very rapidly from a school kid to a soldier. It's something that stays with you for the rest of your life. A lot of people say it's an experience that you wish you hadn't done, but glad you did do. I would say that it was a good experience. It's a really accelerated university of life.
Yeah, I think the big thing, Paul, is that you were forced and you had to put your life and trust in these other guys, that they would do their job and pull their weight to do everything that would protect you.
Yeah, that was very interesting because obviously, I'm just trying to think how many was in the squadron. There must have been about 100 or 200 guys in the squadron. I can't remember. But yeah, you take a bunch of guys, even in a bungalow. I mean, there was one of us, 20 of us in a bungalow sometimes. I can tell you for sure, I didn't get on with everybody. And that was your close companions. There were some of the guys that let you down on a sort of day-to-day basis in certain tasks and things. But when it came to the crunch, everybody knew that everybody relied on each other. When the crunch came, everybody pulled together. I can't think of a single instance when anything happened that somebody didn't pull together. Don't think you understand the concept until you've sort of trained together, worked together, sort of lived together and fought together, that you sort of can rely on people and there's that like you say, that bond.
I think for me, the highlight was actually the border duty in being in Angola. That was, I mean, to me, that was the whole point of being there, you know, and it was fun. It was great, if one can call it that. It was a great learning experience. You know, you got to know yourself, you got to know your buddies. It was a cohesive team that was very, very nice to be part of. Even though I was a B echelon, still being in Panza, I felt that sort of esprit de corps, being part of that group, being a small unit. I mean, let's face it, SSB was never a huge organization, so you had that more intimacy than one would have in the larger units, the infantry, for example.
We will now play The Last Post. This piece of music was originally played in military camps to mark the end of each day and announce that all soldiers should be resting. The Last Post symbolizes that the duty of the dead is over and that they can rest in peace. During this time, you might like to close your eyes and think about all the men and women who have served in times of war and conflict and about those who have died. They shall not grow old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them.